Without wasting any time, I want to invite Pastor Jeremiah and Pastor Felix Ekwuche. Shall we welcome them? This race is an individual race. Escaping from the wrath is an individual and personal decision. You can be in a marriage and you have to make a personal and intentional decision to escape from the wrath of Christ. And so as you hear, as we've been hearing and listening to the voice of the Lord, let your heart be open. For God has something to say. God has been speaking. He is speaking. He'll continue to speak. He has something to say. And may the Lord bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen. How many of you love it when someone, you offend somebody and just like it? Which one would you prefer, an outburst or a silence?
One of them.
Okay. You know, there are some cultures that you would rather let your have your parents mark them with silence. Some silence and you don't get to ask. I would rather the voice seems to mark me than when I do something I expect you to talk, you didn't talk. I do something I expect you to get angry. You swallow your hand and get silent. It's more dangerous. But you see that one that will go, why did you hear it? No, I'll prefer it so that we can go.
Praise the Lord.
After receiving what you have said this afternoon, thank God, is there any other thing? But I still say what he gave me to say. But you know what? Even I didn't say anything, I'm so loaded. We are so loaded. Amen. I'll share with us briefly on the negative silence of God. Do you know, I always talk of discipline in preaching. If you give me 5 minutes, I don't exceed it. If you give me 2 minutes, I don't exceed it. Even if you give me 1 hour, so we'll be given 20 minutes. So I'm not, my time is done. That means up to 5 hours. So I mentioned I would stay with this. I'm not going to say, oh, the Holy Spirit needs me. No, Holy Spirit is disciplined also. God's silence can be positive or negative. When God is silent, if it's positive, you are doing something good. Maybe it's allowing something to work through you. He's taking you through a process. Then he keeps silent. That is a good silence. But he's walking things with you. The one I'm going to focus on today is negative silence. When God is negative, the silence over you, you are finished. When you do something that you know is wrong and God is silent, something is wrong. You see, everything we have had. I want to just take a scripture. The Bible says in Hosea 4:17, Ephraim is joined to idols. Let him alone. Let him alone. When God lets you alone, it's not wrong. Israel is joined to idol. Let him alone. Brethren, has God let you alone? Let the church alone. Let the ministry alone. Let him alone. I have spoken. I have warned him. He's not listening. Let him alone. Let God not let us alone. The church, I don't know where you are, but take where you are, brother, sister. You may be a preacher, the best preacher, the powerful prophet, the powerful evangelist, but if God lets you alone, you are not. Don't get to a place in your life where God lets you alone, where God gives you over to do what you want. We can be the church. We can have good fellowship. We can have wonderful worship. We can do all the things we're not thinking it is God. And God is silent. God, I need to pray to where he's going to watch. God, I need to pray where he's not interested in. When God keeps silence over, you find out what kind of silence it is. Because if God is negatively silent towards you, that is God. If God has reached a point where he said, let him alone. And it is because he has warned, he has spoken, just as we have encountered this afternoon. We encountered him this afternoon. He warned. There was repentance. There was conversion. And you are not moved. You are not moved. It is as if God was just saying, has God let you alone? It's a dangerous question. Because when God lets a man alone, that man is walking towards the rod of God. If when he joined to idols, let him alone. God can leave you alone if you continue to ignore or to resist him. God can leave you alone. Pastor, God can leave you alone if you continue to ignore the warning of God. Is that God can let you know if you continue to ignore all that you have been hearing. Sister, brother, it does not matter who you are. God is not a special person. Let him know. Israel is joined to me. How many do you think that many churches God has let them alone? How many do you think that many ministers God has let them alone? They are still moving, thinking they are moving in anointing. How would you say that there are many of us preachers God has left alone? We can come with fake miracle. I thank God we all know by maturity now that miracle is not authentication of purity. Because with all your miracles, you can still go to hell. You know, I would think some Christians think that because God is moving powerfully, he is taking place. They will say, oh, God is there. Brother, is there. God may not be there, you may still have water to drink. When we were still disobeyed God, he hit the rock. Did water come out? What did you say? You disobeyed God, I'm not going to come out. No, because there are people who are testing. Water must come out. The fact that God is using me, things are happening, that doesn't mean that God is happening to me. The fact that miracles are taking place, signs and wonders are taking place, the church is filling now, you call the evangelist, oh, there's so much growth, everything that doesn't mean that God is happening to you. Check.
Preach.
God let you. Number two. Hardness of heart precedes God's abandonment. Hardness of heart comes before God abandons you. God does not easily abandon his mother, his child. No. For God to let you alone means your heart is hardened. Have you noticed that before God will expose any man of God that is living in sin, he has warned him in the secret. One that is secret. It's only when that man or woman refuses to repent that he exposes him to the world. When God is the place where he lets you alone, brother, sister, wrong for him. Why are you left there? I'm sorry. What encounter with God? Brother, sister, encounter with God is more important than the praise of men. And who never
pain. We can handle it for ministration. But the
in this upper court. Hey! And God is one in the church. And God is one in the church. And the church is going on with the war drums. And the church is going on with the crusades. And the church is going on with all that are planning. The budgets, the big budgets. The church is doing their own thing. And God is saying, this is not me. I am not in this. That's the place for me. That's my place. The church is ignoring God. The church is putting their own way. And it's a fire.
All of my attention.
Strip it all away. Strip it all away. All the tries to steal my heart's affection, I don't need it anyway. If it leads my heart astray, Lord, only you deserve all of my devotion. Lord, strip it all. Lord, strip it all away. The praise of man, Lord, strip it all away. My own ambition, Lord, oh, strip it all away. The need for friends, oh, strip it all.
Believe me, were to go home now, we've got enough for the year. However, the best is yet to come. Hallelujah. I'm going to invite someone. You know the Lord, all that gets this commission is all around it. However, when you look at a car, you don't see the engine that makes the car run, do you? Well, the car goes. Hallelujah. I'm going to call. The Lord is the main agent of this commission. But I'm going to call someone. Hallelujah. Who is the agent behind Apostle? Of course, the man from the Lord. Hallelujah. And so I want to welcome our mommy, Pastor Grace Akalono. Serving the children of God, the saints of the Most High, it's a privilege. Amen. Amen. Those washed in the blood of Jesus. So that's why we do it in humility and not the rest of them. Amen. Right, we're going to sing, and then once we sing, and then we get on. This song is one of my favorite, and Destiny picked it. And he sat down one evening and learned to sing it. And he ran to his mom and said, yes, I can now sing this song. And then he opened his mouth and he said, that's why I said, go to the keyboard. Let's pray. So brethren, relax, sing with us, and then we will take it from there. Good morning. So this song. Bible said, to sing along with me. I dream of the, that the great job make more me.
Thank you.
crying, carried on the next day and cried and wept. Said, Lord, are we not going to hell? Revelation chapter 6. Claire, now list them out. What are we escaping? 6 verse 4. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that served Pharaoh to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great soul. Verse 6. I had a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and the three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou but not the oil and the wine. Verse 8. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto him over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beast of the earth. Verse 12. And I behold, when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and some became black as sackcloth and hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell from heaven, even as a fig tree casted her untimely figs, and when she was shaking in a mighty wind, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of this earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bond man, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountain, and said to the mountains and the rock, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of the wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Now, we need to understand. We know this. But we need to remind ourselves again. Is it Brethren? Revelation chapter 18. So that everything we've been told and we are yet to be told in this conference, there's a reason why the Lord has brought us. And I believe the Lord since yesterday, from the keynote address to the messages, we're yet to hear, we're still yet to hear from the shop. Stand forward and the rest, we are not joking. Amen.
Amen.
We are not joking. I don't think we are joking. If we're joking, we'll see the caliber of people here. And they are not people that joke. That's what they have done. Here, those who serve the Lord are not those that joke, but see us men and women. And soldiers and generals don't joke. You don't joke with the enemy. Not at all. We see what is happening across the world right now. Men flexing their muscles, even the low and the powerful, and everyone going. There are certain things you don't do to the general because you will be playing with your life. They don't joke. You don't joke with Satan. You don't joke with hell. Don't, brethren. Not at all. Take your time. Read Revelation chapter 18. Not a good one there, but it's okay to read it. I remember when I got born again newly, I don't read the book of Revelation at night. I read them about 10, 11, 12. Once it's 4 o'clock, close my Bible, straight, because I'll be shivering. Fear, not at night. Until when I said, one day I said, Lord, why can't I read my book of Revelation at night? Because I still fear in you. This is what to come to you if you have not given your life to me. We've got that at one. Let's go to part two. Now we know the wrath to come. What do we do? Amen.
Amen.
Escape. What is our response?
Escape.
For you to escape, you must know the roots. The roots and crannies. You can't just escape on running right to the enemy's front. There is war now. Those who escape are those who know where the bunkers are. praying is hard. Something happened last year when the war started. And then they could also escape from Russia. They didn't just escape. It took them time. They had the money, they had the car, they had good jobs, they saved up as soon as the news came. And as that news didn't just come, the common man on the street didn't know anything is happening at all. They were privy to the secrets, and they were told what will happen, what is going to happen. What did they do? They entered their car, headed to the border. Before the government could stop them, they done what? Escaped. They had the money, they had the certificates, they had a car, because you can't run to Russian border, it's very far. And they were agile. They were proactive. They left before the conscription. And those who were conscripted did what? They left. They're still there because they got good jobs. So they were employed. But those who didn't can't come back. But they saved up to move. Escape. They did. There's a family friend we knew in Ukraine. Apostle Golden. They live in Kharkiv, Kharkov. Have you heard what is going on? Oh, we heard it, Apostle. Never mind. It's a bluff. They've been bluffing all this while. Nothing will happen. Apostle said, escape from the world. This Apostle will come when you live in England. We live here, we tell you what's going on. They are supporting the journey right now and lost everything because they were sleeping and heard. And what was that? Bombs. They didn't prepare. They were left with their children and couldn't take anything. All the mansion, the church, everything destroyed. They didn't prepare. Even after the war, escape from the wrath to come. Howbeit, when he, the spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you in all truth. That's how we know the nooks and crannies of the scriptures. So those who don't read your Bible, those who take it for life, or those who are forgotten, and those who don't take time, who forget the root, you forget the alleyways, and the subways, and the back ways, you forget the footpath. Go back again. Such the scriptures. Those who will escape have wisdom to understand in time. There's some of us who just do. And we don't. We flow with anything. Like a crowd in the time of our Lord Jesus. Some of them are there to plow, some of them don't even know why they are there. So if you are going to Floxham and Jackson, then you will miss it. You have to be wisdom. Matthew 24:37-39, Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah. Amen. Everything must happen. Isn't it, brother? Those who are reading. I carry on. You must be smart in decision making. You must be decisive right now. No middle grounds. You can't play mediocrity. It will not work at all. Joshua said, choose you this day without yourself. Okay? This way. That's to ask for me and my house. I'll leave it there. You must be someone who has information, knowledge, to hear the gossip in the town. You're always in your wood enclave and their couples, and you don't associate, you don't know what's going on, you will not know what's going on. If you're not in church, you wouldn't know what's going on. If you don't hear the word, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. And please, not just hearing yourself, but sit down and listen to others. Amen. And this is what IMF does. You can see all our leaders sitting and listening to us. Amen. And we are listening to them. Make sure you know what's going on. Don't be in the church and you're not in the church. Please. make sure that you know your Matthew chapter 24-25 very, very well information, so that when you look around, you will know. Please, number 24, I'm not counting anyone. Write it your own. Agile. You will not be stuck in old. If you are as it was in the beginning, so shall it be, and ever you will be stuck. You must know what goes on. Oh, that's the way we were taught. So that's what I believe in. God, the Bible is here for us to learn, because most of us are not to wear what we know as truth. We have picked up from when we go back to the Bible again. What else will help us to go? Diligence. If you're not diligent, you will not escape. If you're not sober, you're going to escape. Another thing is your contingency plan. Some of us don't plan at all. In Luke 14:28, it says, which man going to war or to build a house will not sit down and plan? How can you prepare for this building now? You can see the fire exit, isn't it? Yeah, they planned this house to make room for fire exits. We're coming there in a moment. So short term, mid term, long term. If your short term plan to go to heaven, now we've been waiting. You'll be like those who said, oh, we've been waiting for the days of his return. Why hasn't he come? You will miss him. You have a long term plan, you will endure to the end. The Bible says, he that endureth to the end shall be saved. If you have a short term plan, you must slide. Mid-term plan, you slide away, because we're still waiting. Make up your mind. And in that plan, if you're making it, remember, for those of us who are project managers, you know when you're planning, you put contingency plans, isn't it? And when you've done that, you're going to plan for exceptions, so that when the project is not going according to time or spend more money, you can pick it up and you write an exception report and send forth, isn't it? Now, put up your exception report so that there's certain things that creep in. Hey! Those are creeping when you're born again in the first 10 years. It creeps in afterwards, 20, 25, 30, when you're used to the Lord. When you're blessed and when you taste of your ride, those things will start creeping in again. Watch. Do what? Watch. I know we pray. But please, while you're praying, do what?
Watch.
A lot of people pray. Shall we pray? Yep. If they're not watching. If you're watching, let's carry on. Exits. Don't block the exit. Please. Say the fire exit. Don't block it. Brother Jerry is blocking it. Did you see that? Says, don't block it. What do we block our exits? Escape, malice, compromise, worldliness, religion, shortcuts, thinking God will understand, marching along with others, coming to open gate, dancing with others, speaking in tongues, and your name is not in the book of life. You know it. Compromise, secret sin, going on in our hearts. You know it. Don't know that. Amen. You must drop it and start. Hallelujah. They block the exits. They block it. The trumpet will sound, will pull you down. Victory. Don't let them. Please, my beloved brethren, be careful of compromise. Satan is not coming with two horns to chase us. He's coming through the back door, through the things we neglect, the tiny little things, the little forces that eat up our young mind. Those things, and they call you what? Character. We don't talk about character. Issues of life. What you've been through. The things that overwhelm you. Considering one another in love. Bearing with one another. Checking out for the others. As much as life is in you. Those little things. You neglect them. Watch them. What are they? Exits, grace, goodness, love, mercy, righteousness, holiness. anyone tells you that without it you see the Lord, don't listen to them. Satan is wicked. Hold your head into heaven. I can see their zeal. I know what to do. I'll compromise them. So that they keep going and marching, thinking they're going. When they get there, they will lose it. Don't. Without holiness, you cannot see our God. Some people who are listening these days, or if you preach it, you'll be by yourself. We don't do it anymore so that we can keep people in church. You keep them in here on earth, they will lose heaven. On the last day, they will hold you by the neck. The Bible says you need to go halfway. Do what? Multiply. You will kill what you kill first. Because you didn't tell them to stop the wrath to come. You allow them a compromise. They come in and you hug them. Oh, sister, you look good. Oh, bro, you look good. Here on earth, and they go to hell. Sister, don't look at their faces. Do not fear them. We are drawing them. It's a huge fight, brethren. Do all you can. Those God has brought you away, draw them. Sometimes the children say, Mom, you're talking to us. I will talk till my last what? Breath. I'm not going to do what? Give up. Because Satan is not giving up. That man, no way. He doesn't sleep. His demons are in charge every time. Why should we, brethren? Please, I want to beg everyone. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Pursue him, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Get to know him. Carry on. Take away the excesses. They are not going to hell. The excesses will not take you there. Shut them. They are not essential. Leave worldliness, brethren. Leave malice, bitterness, and compromise. Leave those things. Secret sin. Leave it. They're going to hell. You are going to heaven. Don't. Finally, when you're flying at the airplane, the first thing that they do is what? Drill. Okay? In case there's any emergency. Put your mask there, life jacket, you drop, exit. They do it, isn't it? Do it. When we are on the sea, life jacket, everything, small boats, in case there's anything, there will be announcement, there will be a siren blowing. It will come. Let it not meet us on the way. I was born during the war, Nigeria and from the war. The story my parents told me still with me today. See, they were shelling. And then everyone was running. And they left my great grandmother home. They couldn't take her. She was old, 100 years. So where are they going? And they ran. People lost their children, people lost their husbands, people ran everywhere, escaping, and that was it. It's a terrible story to hear. It will happen again on that day and terribly. So why would I miss Jesus? Why would I sell my bedrooms for a plate of porridge? Oh, dress, go to hell. Amen. That's why we're here. Any Christian who has no intention of going to heaven is wasting his time.
Our time.
Why are you a Christian? Why are you in the church? Please go. We are in the church to go to heaven. We are preaching to go to heaven. We are laboring to go to heaven. My time is gone. God bless you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Amen.
I hope you are very happy because our Lord just finished. And then she touched the heart of God. And I believe we are happy. Praise the Lord. We are going to take offering now. I tell you, this is offering time. Offering time.
Blessing
time. Offering time.
Blessing time.
Good. Now, in my own ministry, we say, when we say offering time, everybody says blessing time. Yes, it's blessing time. But we find out that this is the time that people will start looking for their wallet. Oh, I forgot it in my room. So one day we say, I forgot my handbag at home. Why? We are going to the house of God, you must be prepared. First and foremost, you need to prepare an offering from home, what you are going to give to the Lord. Raise it up to Him. Pray and say, Father, this is my offering. I'm going to your house. I'm going to speak to you because I know you will bless me. So offering time is blessing time. I want you to check yourself now. Whatever you have prepared for this meeting, remember this is the first fruit. This is the beginning of the year. We have all gathered here. This is our first fruit. So it has to be something quality. You have to be prepared for both. You don't have any excuse at all. Because God will bless you this year. Now let's follow into this scripture. You know, this year, God spoke to us in Psalm 65, verse 11. He said, they call you priest, which you are. He said, you are a holy nation. I have gone ahead of you for the year. I have gone ahead of you for the year. He's speaking to priest. He called it holy nation. He said, I've gone ahead of you for the year. Why is he saying that? Because know that you have just entered the year. If God be for us, who can be against us? That is the God we're talking about. He said, I've gone ahead of you for the year. To make all the roads what? All the crooked roads go what? Straight. For you. You priest. Because know that you have a lot to do. You have an enormous work to do. Praise the Lord. So please, I hope we have our ushers. You have it? Okay, that's good. Now what I want you to do now is to put time in your pocket. If you don't have card to give you, get your card. You have to raise it up to heaven. And we're going to pray. Raise it up to heaven. And we can pray about it. He said he has gone ahead of God this year. to make all the crooked roads straight for us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Offering time. Yes, I want you to relate that to your ministers. When you say offering time, I said, whenever we say offering time, everybody will be very, very happy. You know that people who didn't come to church, they even said they are offering from home, but they have known, they know the secret. They know that blessing should come from heaven. A child of God should be told that that's the first and foremost thing, because God has promised. He said, when you give, He said, it shall be given back to you. And when you think what is coming back to you, it has to go everywhere. It has to press down, shake it together. I already know that. Even men, you don't know from anywhere, they shall be given to your bosom, everywhere, all over the place. So it's not something that we should remind us, should be happy whenever it's the offering time. So this is the time we are going to sow to the Lord. Yes. So if you have your hand, you want to raise it up. If you have the envelope, whichever one that you have, we are going to agree. Let us hold God for God to promise. He said, I want somebody to read Psalm 61, Psalm 65, verse 11. Let somebody read it first with me, please. The first person. Psalm 65, verse 11. Yes. Psalm 65, verse 11. What are the Bible scholars? Let somebody read it. I want somebody to read it from the other place. Psalm 65, verse 11.
Psalm 65, verse 11. Am I reading? Right here, sir. Right here. You crown the year with your goodness and your path. You crown the year with your goodness. And your path drip with abundance.
Praise the Lord. You know, I hear from the flower said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. So God has gone ahead to make all the goodness for us. So as you are moving this year, after sowing this seed, collect it, the mercy of God will follow you anywhere. So you have gone ahead to do it for you. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So let's do something now.
That's impossible.
according to your promise, you have gone ahead of us this year to make way for all the crooked ways straight for us. Even the nations that not have ever going to be able to reach, this offering that we have done tonight will make way for you. All the nations that are left for us to reach, the offering will make this time will be a contact point to reach those nations. And what I'm saying is that next year by this time, we are going to give testimony that we are with everybody and God himself will be a witness. Hallelujah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pastor. Hallelujah. As Apostle will say, we want to clap, clap. Checking out tomorrow, check out time is 10:30. So after our breakfast, let's check out. And then we come in here. You don't want to have to pay an extra night if you're not staying over. Hallelujah. And then of course prayers start at 5 a.m. Hallelujah. Maybe like someone I know who thought it was 6. And as she was coming, people were going. Hallelujah. I was that person. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm not competing with my brother. Amen. Amen. I want to invite Apostle George to please come and introduce our guest. Minister.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's a wonderful thing to see what the Lord is doing. I missed, and remember I told you 27 years ago, I missed August between the 8 years, the number of us were brought together by the Holy Spirit in the city of Wilbur. And that foundation prepared the ground for a vision that I've been taking to the Caribbean. It didn't stand. We've been taking to South America, Mexico. It didn't stand. Central America, rather. And that same vision came to the world because we were thinking of the ground. The Lord was processing for this time. And among them, the next speaker is a man who was, you know, one of his main areas was revelatory knowledge of the world. Receive revelation in the world and deliverance. There was a story of when he was younger, he repented early, he did the Lord for over 40 years. And that whenever he went home to the village, his uncle, who is a renowned witch doctor, every single thing will shut down when he comes on holidays. And when he goes back to school, the demons will be able to function. Because he was a radical. It was very hot in those days. Amen. Bishop Stafford is a man of the world, and we thank the Lord for him. The church, facing the church, hosted the first meeting of what became International Ministers Fellowship before we moved to another location. And so it's been there at the foundation, and that's why, by the grace of God, we're going to be trustees, global trustees, apart from being on the Global Governing Council. So join me with a clap offering, giving honor to whom we receive Bishop.
Forever the same, as always. Executive members and the entire IMF present. I appreciate every one of you and your coming to this program has made it a reality. Because if you didn't come, the program will not go. But because you came. And also appreciate those who put together what we are enjoying, the sacrifices, they are not in vain.
Amen.
The Bible said, God will not forget your word. So I just want to nearly, Pastor Cox will have finished everything. But then, because of the word of God, cannot be finished. Every day it evolves. And we won't finish knowing God. Because every day he releases himself in different dimensions. So no one will say, I finished knowing God. And that's why he said, you will know and continue to know. It's not what you will stop. All right. So, flee from the wrath of God. The wrath of God that is to come. That wrath has not come. The wrath is to come. What Jesus did was to deliver us from the wrath. True salvation. So 1 Thessalonians 1:10 is trying to remind us that we are appointed to the wrath of God. But for the sake of Jesus Christ, we came to Jesus Christ. We escaped from that wrath. But the wrath is still there. I want to look at the wrath from the angle of love. For one of the definitions said that the wrath of God is his love in action against sin and wickedness of people. So the coming of the love of God created something different God in the Old Testament will talk about the love of God. In the New Testament, we talk of God being love. God being love. So it's different from the perception of love as related to God in the Old Testament. It's different from the love of God in the New Testament. And then in the Old Testament, that's why those days God can kill instantly. But in the New Testament, God does not do that. Because God is love. And if he's love, the Bible says love does not do evil. So God cannot do evil. God does not kill anybody in the New Testament. God does not punish anybody in the New Testament. Why? Because of the wrath to come. As far as judgment is concerned, as far as punishment is concerned, the wrath has not come. The wrath is to come. So in the New Testament, God is an embodiment of love. God is love personified. God is love himself. So in the New Testament, God does not punish anybody. God transferred, being love, he transferred punishment to three categories of punishments. Punisher number one, yourself. You punish yourself by guilt, by shame, and by torment. Punisher number two, authority. Come in government. That's why in Romans chapter 13, he said that he ordained kings, rulers, whether he called them prime minister, he called them president or kings, he ordained them, commissioned them to be punishers. And they don't punish evil people, they don't punish good people. They punish bad people. He called them his ministers. He called them his ministers. And that they are punishers. So, if you commit anything, you commit. The government will punish you. If you merit prison, you go to prison. The thought is the devil inside. That's the thought punishing. So in the New Testament, you can see that God does not punish anybody. He doesn't kill anybody. He is love. Love does not do evil. Does not even think evil. That is why his wrath is to come. There is a time when he who was a savior will become a judge. When the lamb will become the lion. The wrath of God to come. So when you look at the law of double reference, you see that dispensations. We have too many false doctrines because of be ignorant of law of double reference. For example, the Daniel declared a prophecy that there shall be this dissolution of the temple, abomination. Desolation of the temple. There will be abomination in the temple. There will be another creation, idol, raised up in the temple. In 167 BC, a Seleucid king, Antiochus, the Epiphany God manifesto, captured Jerusalem. And one of the things he did was he spoke to sacrifice. And began to sacrifice pigs in the temple of God. The next thing he did, he raised idol inside the temple. He defiled the temple. For somebody who is not aware of the law of double reference, what happened? The people then concluded that what Daniel prophesied has come to pass. Not until the days of Jesus, when Jesus said, as Daniel prophesied, when you see abomination, which shows that the thing has not happened. But yet, the Seleucid in 166, that's when he entered the temple to do this job. So what am I trying to talk about? What Jesus? Jesus was there, they brought the woman that committed adultery, caught red-handed. And they said, Jesus, what are we to do with this woman? Jesus began to write. They came again. What are we to do with this woman? He raised up his head. What did he say? Is any of you that know you have no sin? Through the first door. He decided to back out. He withdrew until nobody was in him. I congratulate them for that. They were really sincere. Unlike in our days, a good number of them will throw the stone. Now listen to what Jesus said. Woman, where are thy accusers? Did anybody condemn you? Said, nobody. I did not condemn you. Go home and sin. So God is not judging anybody this time. Because he is love. We must not forget that God is love. Until we understand the love the Bible is talking about, many things will go wrong. We are talking about love that you cannot emulate, you cannot cultivate, you cannot buy it. The mistake we do is that we think we can cultivate love. We can emulate love. Those things, how can you do that? You know what we are talking about? We're talking about God. And it is this love that is missing that now abuses our marriages. Divorce here and there. Love does not fail. How can you say today we fall in love and tomorrow you fell out of love? The Bible says love cannot fail. Because it's God. God cannot fail. Therefore, that means we are getting married with their own love. Infatuation. Greed. Because she's working. Because she's buoyant. Love's because it's beautiful. Who told you what you saw is true? The Bible told us that the love that comes from God is a giving love. It's not agape. It's higher than agape. It's a giving love. I did not give you the spirit of fear. What happened? I gave you the spirit of love, the spirit of power, the spirit of sound mind for self-control. It is this love that God gave to Jonathan for love. What did the Bible say? The soul of Jonathan got knitted to the soul of David, that he loved David as his own soul. The love gives. That's why there is no more friendship. Friendship these days is based on what I can gain from you. Therefore, distance can separate us. Relocation can separate us. What are we talking about? We need this love. Sometimes the spiritual force says, I wish that you be knitted together with the love of God. That knitting is not there. And that's why our love is not strong. When God was ministering this to me, I went to my wife. I said, do you know that I don't love you? Yes, I have to say the truth, but she got offended. I was telling her my mind. What I saw from the scripture, do you understand that?
Yes.
I understand what I'm trying to say.
Yes, 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 sir. Yes, sir.
What are we talking about? I began to pray. I said, God, please help me love what? My wife. Until we know this love, we can't enjoy our marriage. Our marriages are so selfish.
Great preacher.
So selfish. Full of competition. Who takes the children? In your absence, the women will be indoctrinating the children. To come on your own side. What are we talking about? Some madness is in existence. How can a woman drag these children of her marriage? It's not supposed to be so. It's unbiblical. You can see it in the
the Bible.
How did you bring it? From where did you bring it? Lack of love makes us pray for people to die. Let him die, amen. Let him die, amen. Loudest amen is when you pray for people to die. The loudest amen. Now, who told you to kill anyone? Our master said, we should pray for those who hate us, not those you hate. Bless them. He didn't say kill them. We have forgotten what happened to Jehu. Jehu who was not planning. He's not a politician. He's just a soldier. God remembered him, picked him up, anointed him, and sent him on air. Go and deal with air. Jehu went. The zeal of the Lord has consumed him. Jehu killed everything related to air. As God commanded, he came back to God. God congratulated him. You have done well. You have did according to my command. Therefore, I will allow your children to come to be enthroned as king in Israel to the 40th generation. Watch what Jehu meant. Jehu now went forward and started killing the people God did not ask him to kill. Anything that associated with Ahab, he finished. Even the people that were coming to visit Ahab, they didn't know that Jehu has killed Ahab. He said, okay, you people come, he took the master and massacred him. And God turned back in the book of Hosea and said, I will deal with Jehu for the blood he shed in Jezreel. Killing people I never asked him to kill. Therefore, I cancel the blessing. And I will deal with him. Don't kill somebody when God never told you to kill. We are in the dispensation of law. Bless your enemy. Pray for them. But you start to kill them, you will give account on the day of wrath. Who sent you to kill and how many people you have killed?
Yes, sir.
Want to use it to show how spiritual and how powerful you are. Killing people up and down. Are you not a terrorist? So what I'm trying to let us understand today is the love of God as it has felt the wrath. And see what happens. When we live here recklessly, we will pay for it. The punishers here will deal with us. If we repent, okay, comes back, God will receive his love. But if you don't repent and decide to abuse the love of God and the grace of God, you are going out of the covenant.
when we talk about hell, we talk about a temporary place of torment for your ungodly. There are four things called hell in the Bible. Sheol, grace. I don't have time to read the place so that I can meet up with my time. You have Tartarus, called hell, Thessalonica. It's a place where fallen angels, angels that have sinned, the angels that committed adultery and fornication are chained in darkness. The Greek call it Tartarus, but it's also called hell. So you find it in the book of in the book of Jude 1:6. You also find it in the book of Thessalonians, Tartarus. That's number 2, number 3, number 3. Then number 4, the lake of fire. Hell is different. The hell where people who did evil, their own temporary place of punishment, a shared neighborhood, a shared neighborhood with paradise before Jesus. It was when Jesus came on the day of resurrection, the graves were opened, and those who died in Jerusalem, they resurrected. In the Bible, we find it in Matthew 27. And the Bible recorded that some of them were given permission to visit people they know, like those who died recently. They had the opportunity to visit their relations and friends. So when Jesus ascended, Jesus took them, transferred the location of hell to the third heaven, which Paul revealed. There is a third heaven called paradise. If there is a third heaven, there must be a first heaven. And first heaven is the atmospheric heaven, inhabited by demons. That's why you hear about the prince of the power of the air. That's the prince of Persia, the territorial demons who control nations. That's their abode. The second heaven, the galaxy, full of planets and water and stars and all the rest. Then you have the fourth heaven, which the Bible calls the heaven of heaven. That's where God dwells. God does not dwell in paradise. Paradise is a place where the believers who die, their temporary place of, and they are still at the place, the temporary place of rest for believers. That's how many believers there will say he went to heaven. The heaven he went is not the heaven of heavens. But nobody has seen God. Even themselves have not seen God. They are in a resting place until the day of the rapture, the day of
first resurrection. I want to bring it to us also to know that rapture is not the second coming of Christ. He who said he will appear to them who are looking for him. It will not appear. Second coming is coming with the sense and everything. All eyes just see, even those who pierce his hand on what I do, before ever the glorious reign of Jesus Christ. So rapture is not the second coming, because it's only those who are raptured, who the Bible says will meet the Lord where? In the air. It is when he will come with his angels, with the saints, that we hear the second coming of Jesus Christ. So what am I trying to bring about? I'm trying to let us understand that the wrath of God did not affect the love of God. God loves you and he loves me. Therefore, what are we to do? In order to maintain this salvation, this deliverance from the wrath to come, we must avoid falling victim . How do we avoid falling victim to the Lord that is to come before the thing will come? We must know God and continue to know him. We must know God and continue to know him through loving him. By loving him through obedience. Love of God. What we have for God is not the money you give. It's not the cathedral or the mansion you build for God. The love of God is just obedience. Simple. It is where our lives miss it. The love you have for your husband is not sex. Is obedience. Wives, obey your husband. It's not sex. It's not romance. It's simply obedience. And it's only through obedience you will know your husband. Many wives don't know their husband. Husbands have a lot of secrets in their heart, unknown to their wives. And that is what John chapter 14, verse 21 is talking about. He that loves me is he that obeys me. My Father will love him. I myself will love him and reveal myself to him. Every secret will be made known. When you begin to obey your husband will trust you. Many of our wives don't know that your husband don't trust you. You see, it's only when you love me will I do what? I will trust you and do what? Manifest myself. Reveal myself. Every day there will be no secret again. Yes.
But outside that, no way. You be pretending. Because your husbands see you as a suspect. That is very, the second thing you will do that, you will say, oh, so you want to kill me. Destroy our marriage. Lack of confidence. Lack of confidence. That is what also happened between us and God. You can never know God except. So you can never know God except you love God. And you cannot love God except you obey God. And you cannot obey God until you humble yourself.
Yes.
It's very, very important to know. One major problem we have in the house is the home. If the home is sick, the church will be sick, the working place will be sick, the nation will be sick. Please, mother, stop entering into competition with your husband.
Well,
marriage is not competition, it's relationship. Don't drag children with your husband. If they are if your husband's children, not your own.
Hallelujah.
That the West have vaccinated.
Long time.
And we are coping from them. How can a wife drag children with a husband to the point of going to court? It's this abomination. Recklessness on the first class one. Ungodliness. It's very ungodly. Women, let me tell you, please, don't hate me. The day your husband married you and paid what did they call it? Down. That's a beautiful name. Your husband bought you. No, listen to me. We are taking marriage to be a social affair. It's not a social affair. It's spiritual. That's why Paul was comparing it with our relationship with Jesus. Have you ever read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20? What did Jesus say? You are bought with a price. You are no more your own. Rachel, call the sister Leah. What are we still doing in our father's house? Genesis 31, verse 14 and 15. What are we doing in our father's house? Are we not regarded as a foreigner? Listen, he has sold us and has devoured the money. No, I want you to understand these facts. You won't know how to behave in marriage.
Yes, Bishop.
Marriage is not a chapter, it's not something you want to do because others are doing it. Or because you're of age. Or because you want to settle down. Since they get back, you have not settled down. I'm telling you the gospel truth. God bear me witness. It's in the scriptures. Let's heal our marriages. We are pretending at all. We are not in good time. We will come in, we will continue to pretend. Eh? Just like those who are dating. Those who are courting. A time of the highest pretense. We are of the truth. Let us abide in the truth. So that the wrath of God will not come. So that you will not meet that wrath that is going to come. So another thing you have to do is try to update yourself. When your Christians go, they don't know. Eh? I woke up some time ago. I went to them. I tried to go to WhatsApp. They said they are updating the WhatsApp. And this they do every 2 a.m. They say, wait, if social media with all intelligence, anything you ask Google will answer. Yes, you needed to be updated. What is it you don't want to be updated? What is it? What is it you don't know? You don't want to know your spiritual status. Where you are, everything will take it for granted. And Jesus is coming very soon. Do you know exactly who you are? So we must get involved in updating ourselves. So we have to remain lowly. Meek and lowly, we are too proud. Pride.
Yes, Bishop.
Even some of us who talk against pride are number one proud. It's not because you put on good dresses or you walk one kind way that makes you proud. No. The most dangerous pride is the one that is not being shown. Eating until something will happen. We must maintain self-denial. That's how to deal with pride. Maintain self-what? Denial. Because if self is not there, there will be no pride. It is self that is proud. Somebody said to be proud when he's full of self. How do you relate with people? That's another area you think about. Do you accept defeat? Can you easily say, I'm sorry? Bible, and they are all up and down doing this, crusade here, this and that. These are this set of people on the last day at that time. They are ready to say many miracles. But Jesus will say what? Stop studying about Jesus. Study Jesus. Study Jesus. Do you know Jesus? Study about God, about this, about that. It's a different thing. Study Jesus. So that you can win. To remind us that the wrath to come is not a portion. The Bible says we are not appointed unto God. And there is no need of being afraid. Fear is a torment. You don't worship God under fear. Wherever the Spirit of God is, there is what? There is liberty. Sin shall not have dominion over you. Why? Because the body of sin has been crucified. The old man is wicked. Therefore, what it means is, it's highly impossible for you to sin. And when you sin, don't accuse anybody. Because the body of sin that compels you to sin, whether you like it or not, the Bible says in the book of Romans that Christ has what? Destroyed it on his cross. In the old man. Therefore, sin have no dominion. So if you sin, blame yourself. You deliberately sin. Because there when you finish sailing, you are going to somebody, a ship to play. Pray always. Men don't pray. Men ought always
pray.
Men can't go for their wives. I thank God my wife can pray. Shut up. Is that what the preacher said? Men ought always, not sometimes, not leaving it for prayers for and prayers there. Paul said, pray with us. Learn to give thanks. Learn to do what?
Give thanks.
Learn to give thanks. And when you give thanks, you know what you have done? You are giving God back what He gave to you. The two to four elements in heaven. And the four beasts is God. They lie down. He removed the crown he gave to them. This is what you give to us. I'm giving you back. We were only captured. We were only of us here.
Give substantially. You see, let's not do all this one part. You know, praise the Lord. all these 2P kind of things. Let's give. If you want to honor somebody, let's honor. If you are not going to honor, let's leave it. But let's do it right. And I know the online people, please, online, the details are they going to be on soon. If you want, substantial giving. Let's honor the people that have come to minister here. Like our GGC, they didn't pay, IMF didn't pay for their class. Praise the Lord, and that's the reality. We didn't. They've come by themselves. But I think it's right that we do something that is good. To say, listen, we honor you, we appreciate the fact that you've committed yourself to come and be a blessing to us. Praise the Lord. So we want to take that, and I just believe that we can do that properly. Hallelujah. We can do that properly. So please, let basketball beyond that, yeah, let that go around. But please, you can do an online transfer. Put the seed of honor at the reference, seed of honor 2024, so that we can sort that out. Praise the Lord. So please, let's rise. Let's do it properly. Let's do it properly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's sing. We are not giving something, we are not angry. Let's dance and let's pray the Lord. Hallelujah. Please, yes, please. Hallelujah. Please, just give up one song. Hallelujah. Let's take the offering. If you're giving online, please make sure you reference it. Seed of Honor 2024, so that we can collect that and bless the ones who have come. And if you're giving cash, please put it in there. Great. Hallelujah.
We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord.
Yeah. Sorry, if you are giving my card, you can see Pastor Lee's at the back, please. But we have the facility, so you can pay my card. And it is PayPal, IMF, OpenGate, at gmail.com. That is the PayPal as well.
We bring the sacrifice of praise.
Father, we know that we have not given enough, but by your grace, Lord, you will take it further. It shall be a blessing unto them. By your name we be glorified. In the mighty name of Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
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 If few announcements, please, you will be seated. Please, for the people from America, I understand you will need to see Pastor Lee probably tonight or tomorrow morning. And then, for everyone who is driving and they have a seat or two available in their car going towards London, maybe Oxford, Birmingham, or wherever, please indicate so that we can take one or two people with you. We have brethren around who we have need of transport. And if you have need of transport, please let Pastor Lee know as well. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have a young one amongst us that has produced a CD. And we want to encourage that one. Amen. A 9-year-old that has produced a CD. Please, the CDs are at the back there. Let us pick up one and bless someone. Amen.
Amen.
And that one will be encouraged. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There is no time, and we have asked that child to come and bless us with a song. But we are running out of time. Amen. I'm going to invite Pastor Jeremiah to come very quickly for more announcements. By the way, please don't go. At the end of his announcement, the GCC will be out here. Our elders will be out here to bless you. So please don't go. Amen.
Well, Pastor Kevin, how is the response for the 11th? Because that's very really important. We are talking about our next generation, and this announcement will continue to reinforce the forms. And then you say, Pastor Kevin, what is the response? No. So we continue to ask, please, the forms must be filled because we may do and enjoy and do everything. Our next generation is very important. And this one will continue to announce it. So please, do the filling of the form right at the back there. And I think we'll take it a very, very important place. Okay? Okay. Very important announcement. If you're here for the first time, you have got a beautiful present. You lie down there. Pastor Peter has got a present for you. So when we finish, if you are here, if you are in my life for the first time, or this is your first couple game, you will just go behind that now and suggest a custom present for you. Can I say, Apostle Jeremy, the GTC, instead of everybody waiting, the following countries, please, all the leaders, UK, USA, Italy, Ireland, South Africa, and Nigeria. These six countries, all of your national leaders, your deputies, please, you will come and wait and go back in there. The meeting that was supposed to take you and couldn't take you, that these countries will once more, UK, USA, Italy, Ireland, South Africa, and Nigeria. Please, as soon as we finish, please, let's move over there. We have that meeting. And I want to say thank you to Bishop Stafford for that powerful delivery. I'm also trusting tonight, one day we'll have seminar for men to know how to talk to the husbands.
Yes.
No, let me tell you, I was discussing with my wife. The problem we have is that there are many sound wonderful sisters, without her brothers, we don't have a husband. And then we need that singing.
Forevermore. Amen.
Good night.